the special public hearing for tonight for the 2017 proposed capital projects and bus replacement plans at 7:04 p.m. Those plans were published as required in the paper. Are there any questions or comments on the proposed 2017 capital project or bus replacement plans? Last call. Motion to adjourn the public hearing on the capital projects and bus replacement plans.
So just move, we close this special session. All right, so moved.
Second.
Discussion on that? Hearing none. Those in favor of adjournment of the public hearing say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. And we are adjourned at 7:05. Thanks for coming, everybody. Sorry. All right. Now, call to order the regular September 2016 meeting of the Argos Community Schools Board at 6 p.m. Volunteer for leading us in the pledge tonight. Brad Carter looks like he's really wanting to do that.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, as has been the norm lately, we will now observe a moment of silence. Use that however you deem appropriate. Item three, patron communication. A couple ground rules. If you would please raise your hand, then when recognized, stand, state your name. We ask that comments be kept relatively brief, and if someone has made a point already, please do not restate that point in observance for time purposes.
My name is Kirk Weiss, varsity baseball coach as of now. I have a couple questions. Tonight I'm going to be terminated. I was asked to resign. I did not resign. I'd like to know the reason exactly for being asked to resign. If I understand right, it's because the contracts were already approved before. That's one reason. Is that correct?
As far as?
One of the reasons I'm being asked to resign tonight.
Well, the position had already been approved by the board for renewal.
And that was where the conflict had come up, right?
Correct.
Okay. And the second reason, communication with the athletic director. Is that correct?
As far as that's the reason that was given?
Yes, I'm just wondering what the reason was.
You guys want to go into what was talked about in exec session on that?
Not really.
I mean, it's as far as the specifics go, I think that that's been communicated to you. I don't want to get too far into the personnel side of it.
Okay. My question is, why am I being held accountable for contracts that were not asked be approved by me and were approved before my season was even over. Because I believe everywhere in the else in the state of Indiana was contracts are discussed at the end of the season review between the head coach and the athletic director. There's even a part on the end of my thing that says, circle one, recommended for contract renewal. If they're recommended before the season was even over, why even circle that? Why would even that be brought up? I had no, was not asked about it. I was not, nothing about it. Those were done before my season was even over. I made a coaching change. I made that coaching change because it didn't work out. I've told people involved, you were asking me to sit down and have a conversation. I had 2 months before I even took the job, before we even switched roles. There was tension last year, and my main concern and only concern are those kids, period. In the comment section of my review, the athletic director wrote, I like the communication you had with the athletic director, the enthusiasm you had for the program, drawing kids in. You and your assistants need to decide if you can get on the same page regarding practices, roles, and make it work. If not, we will find other assistants.
We had your evaluation.
Okay. As a head coach, no one else is up here getting fired tonight. I am. My job is to worry about those kids. It's not to worry about what parents think, what administration thinks. You don't coach and get paid what you get paid for anything except those kids. I don't take time away from my family for anything except those kids. I made a decision that I wasn't going to risk causing tension next year in the program. I didn't break any rules. I did what every coach in the state of Indiana does. They sit down, they evaluate, they make a decision. I made a decision. I was man enough to take it. I heard all the rumors being spread about me. I didn't defend myself once because I didn't care. Those kids are all I cared about. I was man enough to make the decision. I was man enough to put all the blame on my back. That's completely fine. But the yo-yo that happened in this whole situation is unacceptable. I go a month without even knowing there's a problem. And then I go into a meeting where I'm assured that it's just a, hey, let's mend a friendship meeting. And then at the end of that meeting, I'm told, well, I'm going to take this to the board and we'll let the board decide. 1 month after it happened, we are 3 months out from when this happened. I can't find another job if you fire me tonight. It's too late. If I did something wrong, you fire me on June 23rd, the day after it happened. I'd asked to resign before. I brought it to the attention of the superintendent, told the entire story. I was told not to resign. I was told, hey, my recommendation is you. Then I hear, well, the board's going to decide. So then the board, I get word back from the board, hey, it's you. Then I make the front page of my hometown paper, the Pilot, where the board's saying, hey, he did nothing wrong. It's his job till he resigns. You know, the athletic director, principal, and superintendent said those two will never work together again. A week later, I'm called into the office, asked to resign, mend things up with my old assistant, and reapply. This has been 3 months for a simple coaching change. I made a decision that a couple people weren't happy with. That happens. I was hired to build a program. Argos baseball is being talked about more than it ever has. We had $1,800 in banners and sponsorships last year. I had $1,500 already pledged for this year. I had blueberry parking notes. For one day, it was all the money was going to go to Argos baseball. I had the kids do a community service project as a team, which at Argos, they said they don't do. You can't call parents and ask them what coach they want, like the athletic director did in this situation. You can't do it. Because how do you explain to those parents that didn't get called how that looks? Because it looks shady. It just looks shady. I live in Plymouth. I have no connection to Argos at all. The only connection I had were those kids. But yet I went through this for 3 months and I'm standing in front of you today fighting for it. That should tell you something. I've been above board on everything. You asked me to resign. I informed them I would not reapply for the job. I called Mr. Nellens. Told him, hey, thank you for letting me coach at Argos. I appreciate it. I said, I had already started practices. I had laid out a plan for these kids, two practices a night, a week, three times a week in the winter. And then I get yanked up from under my feet. You need to resign. I told him that I'm going to honor that promise and I'll work those kids out for 3 weeks until tonight, until you fire me. That's the right thing to do. I have a meeting, parent meeting, with the board president in hand and tell him that situation. I have two practices. I have nine kids in August show up at Argos to practice baseball. After the athletic director sees us out there. The next day, my kids are called down to the lobby to be told the principal's going to take over practice and start next week. I'm still your coach. Until tonight, I'm still your coach. And then you send those kids back to class. And they've been told, hey, Coach Weiss is going to practice us for the next 2 weeks. And now we're going to switch it up. You think those kids were paying attention in those last couple classes? You can't do that to kids. We're in the business of kids. You can't do that. We were building a program. You saw what I did in a year. Imagine what I can do in 3 and 5 years. We're in the business of kids. The successes I don't see on the field. I see a kid that got suspended all last year because he couldn't play because he did something stupid. And I sit down with his parents and tell them, hey, you can practice with us. You mess up one time, you're done this year and next year. Kid did great last year. I see a kid that had 3 F's. I sit him down. No practices, no nothing. He's playing soccer this year because he's eligible now. Kid's calling me at night. Hey, coach, I'm having a problem in school. Let's talk about it. Kid talked me on the field. Hey, my girlfriend broke up. Let's talk about it. That's what it's about, period. I'm in peace if you guys fire me tonight, because this has been a yo-yo effect that's affected me and my family. I'll move on. I'll find another job. I have an assistant that'll go with me. But we're in the business for the kids.
Thanks, Coach. The athletic director, or any of the board would like to weigh in on any of that. Just for clarity's sake, as a parent of a player on the team, I didn't feel it appropriate for myself to be involved in decisions on this. And so I've recused myself from any of the decisions involved here. So. Anyone else with comment tonight?
I just have some questions. Can I just stand?
Please.
First time.
And you are?
Tara Ringer. I have two students in elementary. I have some questions about your guys' grade scale. And I spoke to Mrs. Reese about it. It was in January, December. My kids came here over Christmas break last year, and your grade scale is completely different, and I understand. I graduated from Argos in 2004. I just want to know why the elementary grade scale is different than high school. You're one school. I don't understand why we don't have one grade scale.
That's a good question.
Yeah, it only makes sense. Your Argos community, you need to be a community and just do, I mean, anything under a 95 is a B. That's just, that's rough for a kid. You're not doing anything for the confidence level. You're not. I mean, it tears my kids up. I'm just going to be honest.
I can comment on that, I think, because I've had these same questions and I've sat with teachers as a parent of an elementary child. And we've been talking about this grading scale since my daughter was in school. And that's been 8 years here. And I've sat with elementary school teachers on task force, whatnot. One of them in the room who advocates very highly for the higher grading scale at the lower level to prepare those children for, you know, what's to come. And yes, they are held accountable to a higher grading scale. And, you know, personally for us as a family, we just adjusted our expectations of that and what those grades meant. And I'm not going to put Mrs. Zentz on the spot, but I mean, unless you feel that's an unfair representation of conversations we had had over the grading scale, but our Council of Teachers at the elementary highly advocates for the grading scale that exists today.
Okay, you're trying to prepare the elementary students for high school, but the grading scale isn't the same.
Well, the high school grading scale can be individual based on teacher as well. So,
but then it says when it comes to report cards, it breaks down very precise what the grades are. So even though the teachers may have their individual grading scale, is that washed out, just thrown out when it comes to report cards? Because it's not what it says in the handbook.
I don't know what grade.
It's two different. Well, high school, I'm just saying if we're holding elementary kids and we're preparing them for high school, I understand that. But it's not the same grading scale, and teachers can make their own. But when it comes to report cards, they have to do the basic report card scale. That's what it says in the handbook. My other question is, who votes? Because I was told the board votes on the grading scale.
We approve a handbook, correct? We do not specifically.
Because I've also been told other parents, what about involving the parents? And do we have any kind of say? Like, is there surveys, or can we come vote? And just besides, like, someone's got to spread the word, because I didn't know that we could come here and voice our concerns like this. I never knew that. So I just think that maybe you should involve parents a little bit more on the grading scale. Tutoring, homework club. I mean, is there anything? I do know you offer a tutoring. My kids did it last year. I'm not going to lie, it was a joke. I mean, I was told the kids get there, they sit down on computers, and then they come home and they still have homework. I mean, to me, tutoring is either A, one-on-one help, or B, group help, or if you have homework, you're not understanding how to do it. Why are you still coming home with your homework incomplete? Or take a piece of scrap paper and write down examples so my kids know how to do it when they get home, not going, I still don't understand it. I mean, is there any kind of homework club, or do we have high school helpers, or any kids that are in study hall? Because I know when I was in high school, we could go down to elementary, we could go to special ed in high school, we could go to the special ed in elementary, and we could volunteer our time during study hall to go help. Do we still offer that?
Mm-hmm. They do that. When high school kids have free time, so they can come down and help out in the elementary. The after-school tutoring, we just started meeting on that, so we want to refine it. So we're trying to focus on the standards that they're not passing or not mastering or having trouble with. So yes, we've had started the discussions, and I just did that with fourth grade, and we'll be doing that with each grade level. as we get ready to institute it, and we hope to do that by October.
Okay, and that's when the tutoring will start?
Yes, yes.
Okay. And then another thing it said in the handbook on page 12 was, I just did third grade because that's what grade my son is in. Kids have to have a C minus, which is 74% or higher for passing. So right now he's got three D's, an F, a B, and an A. So those three D's, they're a 72, 73. If he doesn't bring those up, he's going to be held back for that? I don't think that's fair when you're that close. Technically, that's not a D, that's still a C.
I don't know what you're referring to, so I'm sorry.
That's okay, but it's on page 12 in the handbook. I don't have the handbook.
And I don't either, I'm sorry. And I can get back to you on that one.
Okay.
Michelle, is that the decision to pass or fail a child at elementary level made collectively with the teacher as opposed to not passing a subject?
I'd have to read it to see what, I don't know, do you know what
it's
referring to?
That's been past practice anyways. Teacher sits down with parents, sometimes administrator, and it's more probably than test scores. It would be scores that they had received in the classes. We did have a retention policy at one time about, you look back at ISTEP scores, if he's in third grade, there'll be a standard there for the IEP score too.
Yeah, that's the other issue. He was held back this year, so he's repeating third grade because he didn't pass the IEP, which I understand that's state, it's nothing to do with this, you're automatically retained if you don't pass IEP, but even though he's repeating third grade, he's still not doing well, which leads into my other issue. I called and left a message. I think it was the elementary psychologist or psych. I don't know exactly what her name was.
Psychologist, not psychiatrist. Okay.
And I requested to see maybe if he has any type of learning disability since he's not doing better. Mm-hmm. And he did retake the IEP, scored lower the second time. She said we have to see if he qualifies.
Mm-hmm. There's some guidelines, so you'll want to sit down with her and talk about that.
But if I, the parent, am asking for my child to be tested, when do we have to see if they qualify? It doesn't matter what I want.
You start the process, and then you have to go through the process of looking to see if all the steps are qualified him to be. It's not a yes or a no.
Okay.
So I mean, not an absolute yes. You are on the track of being evaluated. So you'll want to definitely talk with her.
What's her name?
And I can get that for you. Okay.
Would you get him into like a Jesse program, like the Rose?
I can get that for you.
Okay. Title I program. I know we did that before, mm-hmm. but I haven't had any information about that yet this year. No one's contacted me to see if he's going to go back.
I can talk to you afterwards.
Okay. That's it. All right. Thanks.
Thanks for your concerns.
Yes.
I know there have been some differences within the building. In fact, until this year, the grading scales did not align, or I mean, the grading periods did not align either. There was differences in the different ends of the building. One was on a 6-week scale, the other was on the 9-week. I think that was this year, or maybe it was last year that got changed. So there have been traditionally some differences in the different ends of the building. I'm not nearly intelligent enough to talk to you about a grading scale because I don't teach. So, but it's certainly a good concern to bring forward, and it's worth some additional thought and discussion, I think.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. One thing I didn't know earlier at the start of the meeting, which I should have, is that agenda item number 10 is scheduled for tonight. It's not ready, the approval of the 2016 CPF plan amendment. There were some weight adjustments which did not make it for tonight. So item 10 is stricken, and then item 11 and up would be renumbered accordingly. Item 4 is the approval of the minutes from the August meeting. as well as four subsequent executive sessions. And I'll entertain a motion regarding the minutes.
Move that minutes be approved as presented, items A through E.
I'll make a second.
Discussion on those minutes. Hearing none, those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Did
that all of them?
I have to abstain because I wasn't at one of the meetings.
Ah, okay.
Sorry. Didn't mean to throw you out there.
I just thought my hearing was off. So, okay. 301. All right. Personnel changes. We have items A through F, and they can be either acted on collectively or individually.
Motions that we approve items A through F as stated on the sheet.
There's a second?
Yes, I'll make a second.
Discussion on any of the items A through F.
Question on F. Carly McKay and Rusty, what are they for the varsity 7th, 8th grade coaches?
Both varsity?
Okay. Kind of thought that, but I wasn't sure. Thanks.
Kind of, sometimes on those, like to leave it a little generic just because they will, the varsity coaches will often work with the entire program. So.
Any other discussion? Well, I don't know how the vote's going to come out, but I do appreciate Coach Weiss coming tonight and speaking up. And obviously, he has some passion for the program. I appreciate the time and the effort that he has committed to the kids. I don't know how the vote's going to go, but. I do appreciate that as a parent, so I thank you. Hearing no other discussion, those in favor of personnel items 5A through F, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Did you say aye, Jen? You did? Okay. And again, I will abstain. So that's 301. Item 6, elected school board update. Mr. Gary Calhoun came last month and gave us some background on kind of a drive for some changes in the way that the school board is selected. We are one of the few remaining appointed boards in the state. And again, the township advisory boards approve four of the five board seats. The town council approves the fifth. So in essence, you have three people deciding 80% of the makeup of the board. Well, three people deciding 40% of each, a different three people deciding the other 40%, and then five people deciding the remaining 20% of the makeup of the board constituency. And so there was a petition, or not a petition, but a help me out. A motion.
It would be a resolution of the board.
Resolution. Thank you. The word escaped me for some reason tonight. He provided us free of charge a sample resolution if we chose as a board to change the makeup of the board, or actually the selection process thereof. And so we said that we would put that as an agenda item for tonight for discussion. And I guess I'll open that up for the rest of the board members for any thoughts they have on that.
I guess I see it as the most expedient way of getting it done.
Any other thoughts?
I think it's probably the right thing, but as far as how things are kind of perceived here lately, it seems like, I almost think that being on the ballot would maybe be the better way to go, so you get the total, not as you get what people really do want, as far as just moving forward on it.
I guess I would kind of echo Doug's thoughts. I don't have an issue with the elected board, and again, vast majority of the state has gone that direction, and I think that the idea of just a handful of people picking the board, you know, I don't think that that's necessarily proper. But on the other hand, I also don't feel like we should unilaterally change the bylaws of the school when the corporation was founded over 50 years ago. And so if the people do in fact want to change the makeup of the board or the selection process thereof, then I think the petition remonstrance process is the proper way to do that. Mr. Calhoun even told us last month that even if we decide as a governing body here to change those bylaws, if one person objects in writing to our change of that, we'd have to go through the petition process anyway. And I can't think of anything that we would decide that not one person would have an issue with. So I think that's where we would head anyway. I know that they're smart enough people to organize that process to where we wouldn't have to fund any sort of a special election price, but that it would coincide with either a midterm or a regular fall election. So I'm confident there wouldn't be any cost to the school corporation for that. And I also think that, you know, if we go to an elected board, I think that the makeup of the board and the representation among the board of the populace of Argos should reflect current demographics, meaning that there's a lot higher percentage of the population who reside inside town limits now than was the case when the school corporation was founded in the 60s. As such, I think that whatever that makeup should reflect what those numbers look like. So if 40% of the population of the school corporation live within town limits, then 40% of the board should be made up of people who live within those town limits. Or if it's the other way, then, you know, go the other direction. So I think that that would be logical to look at that particular situation at the same time as a complete realignment of the selection process itself. Other discussion?
I think I have to agree with you on the election process, that it should probably have at least three elected and two at large, something along that way to help cover the town. I think the town's got the short end of the stick for several years. So. And I do agree with it. I just think that, as the young lady up here stated, I think we need to get more citizen involvement, and I think that's probably the best way to go about it.
So, is there a motion regarding the selection of the school board membership? Okay. Hearing none. Item 7, Old Gold presentation.
We have Johanna here tonight. She's the president of the Old Gold, and she wanted to do a presentation to share what Old Gold is all about. So, Joanna?
I'm sorry, I didn't turn my back to you. My name is Johanna Bauer. I am president of the Argos Old Gold Boosters. And for those of you who don't know what that is the parent organization here at the school. Michelle came to a group of us parents about a year and a half ago, and she said, you know, I really want to see you guys have a parent organization at the school again. Why wasn't there one? Well, I think, I can't speak from the old gold portion of it, which at the time was the athletic high school portion. I know it dissolved. I'm not exactly sure why, but I know that there wasn't anything at the high school end any longer. In the elementary end, you had pep club. And pep club ended up dissolving because of lack of parental involvement. So there wasn't anything on either end. So what we all kind of came together and decided was, let's get something that is corporation-wide. So Argos Old Gold Boosters, and that's quite a mouthful. We sat here one night trying to come up with a name and decide what the best name for the organization was going to be. And we decided, well, we wanted Argos in the name. Old Gold, well, we thought that sounded pretty good. It's our school colors. Boosters, and that's what we are. We're boosters to try and boost our kids and provide good things for them. Part of what our mission statement is to create a partnership between Argos Community Schools administration, staff, students, and parents in order to support Argos students' academic, extracurricular, and future success. We want these kids, when they walk out these doors, to be a success. This organization provides support pre-K through 12. Some things we do are geared toward the elementary. Some are geared more towards high school. And we try to come up with things that are organization-wide. We are a club made up of four officers, I being the president, Angie Flory is our vice president, Tracy Calhoun is our secretary, and Melanie Dean is our treasurer. We also have several different committees, if you will. We have a family events and activities committee. We have our bylaws. We have our fundraisers. We have parent and community communications. We have a group that does locker decorations when it's time for a sporting event. That's who is going to help us decorate the lockers. And we also have a couple of staff members that is part of our organization. Some of the things we have done, we last year had what we call donuts with the VIP right here in the library. We wanted you to bring in a very important person in your life that you could come in one morning before school and bring them and show them, this is our library, this is our school. Mrs. Reese was here to meet and greet those people. And we had a lot of elementary participation on that, and when it was almost time for the bells to ring, here comes our high school kids. And that, I think, brought the biggest grin to my face that day, because they came in and they're like, oh, donuts, can we have some? You feed high school kids, they're happy. In February, we had what we call our cupcake and canvas event. We kind of took that along from a spin of wine and canvas. We had our cupcake and canvas. And what we were able to do with that, we brought in parents and a child, and they came in, and we worked with our art club, Haley Hampton and Bailey Nifong. We wanted kids from our art club. We wanted to support our art club. They came in. They made two designs. We had a simpler design. We had a little bit more difficult design. We packed that cafeteria, and everybody had a really great time. We like to support our local businesses. Last year, we did for the first time our Sugar Shack fundraiser, Sugar Shack Bakery in Plymouth. We coordinated with Stephanie on that, and sold a lot of fudge. We sold a lot of fudge. We raised over $9,000selling fudge and candies, and it was very well received. We have movie nights. That was something that Pep Club had done. The kids always enjoyed that. They come in the auditorium lobby, we have hot dogs and popcorn and a soda, and then they get to bring a parent or any other special significant other, and we show a movie on the screen. And it's really a lot of fun. And we go through a lot of hot dogs. If you hear the theme, we like to eat a lot. But not only that, we support the groups. Last year, We supported Hannah Harrell. We gave a monetary donation to help her make her way to BPA Nationals. We gave monetary support to our girls when they were going down, our girls' basketball team, when they were going down to state. We also like to help out any way we can. Last spring, it was a cold day. It snowed, and we were outside cleaning up around outside, raking leaves, spreading mulch. It snowed that day. We had planned on it. Nobody expected it, but it was fun. And then in the fall, we finished up that spring cleanup day, and we cleaned up the soccer slash baseball bathrooms, and we painted those. And part of that, which was another good thing for some of our seniors, is they came along and the seniors helped, and that helped them to earn some of their community service hours. And this past weekend, we had our Lincoln Drive event, and we offered it to seniors. Please come and help. This can also be part of your community service hours. I see a lot of faces that were here on Saturday, and I appreciate everybody that came out and drove. We had 295 drivers. We have roughly raised $5,900 from that Lincoln Drive event. So we're very thankful to Oliver Ford for working with us, and to everybody that came out and drove. And also through Oliver Ford, our girls soccer team had an ounce of prevention soccer game supporting breast cancer. And our girls came out, they got new uniforms, and we had our paint game. And the girls had a lot of fun. And the nice part of that is they played with Plymouth, and we took a picture at the very beginning of the game, and you didn't have half pink uniforms and half white uniforms. They were mixed, they were interspersed. So they're learning to work with other schools and other people in order to raise monies for a very important cause. So I guess to me, this is all about the kids. That's what Old Gold is about. We're here for the kids, and we want to support our kids. Does anybody have any questions about Old Gold?
Just thanks for the new curtains in the bathrooms. I remember what those were like. It looks nice. That and the other one.
Thank you very much.
And I want to thank the Old Gold. They do a lot for the school. So let's give them a round of applause.
All right. Washington, D.C. trip. Mr. Fishburne.
It's me.
You look like you're just chomping at the bit.
Yeah. I'm excited about the possibilities of this. This is actually, I know the school board, you received all the information and were able to look at it, I trust. Right? Okay. But I did want to show this video for everybody else. What we're planning and what we'd like to do, proposing to do, is to take junior high kids on a trip to Washington, D.C. And you might wonder, why 7th and 8th grade? Why in the world? I say, why not? And that's an important time in their life. And I think it would be an awesome opportunity for them. So we'll just watch this, and then I'll mention a couple of things and see if you have any questions.
You learned in school how Washington, D.C. is home to many amazing sites that tell the incredible story of our country. To see and feel the history, energy, and impact of our nation's capital with your own eyes. Your day will be packed from morning to night. There's so much to do in Washington, D.C. Inspiring memorials that capture our nation's history. To some of the greatest museums in the world, Smithsonian Museums, United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, Mount Vernon, and many others. You and your friends will create your own memories to share for years to come.
My good friend has been Lincoln Memorial because I got to finally see it in real life instead of on a computer.
It was pretty cool. We got to ride by this airport rock. We were actually riding one, so we got to drive it. And then we got to touch a moon rock.
I think it's really amazing how they can fit so many big, huge monuments and memorials for those people who really deserve it. And they can keep it in a way so that everyone can view it, yet it's very respectful for them.
The memorial really brought a heartwarming news because my brother was in the Marines and it was kind of hard seeing him go all the time.
This is not your ordinary history lesson. America's past comes alive before your eyes. Reach out and touch history.
The Martin Luther King War, it was really something meaningful to me because he fought for my rights and I really appreciate that for him. So when I read a part of his speech, it made me feel really happy deep down inside.
And witness firsthand the traditions that make our country great.
Arlington is my favorite thing because when we were changing the guards, it was so good because they were doing everything perfectly. And I want to join the military, so I was like honored to watch that. And it takes your breath away.
It was amazing. It was one of the main things to see.
Trip will be led by your own course leader to share fun facts and answer all your questions along the way.
So far, my favorite thing has been how detailed our tour guide goes into when he's talking about the monuments.
His brain's pretty chill. He explains stories by them, paints a visual picture that you can, just see. It's pretty cool.
He probably knows everything about everything. If you ask him what Lincoln's favorite pizza was, he could probably tell you.
We're seeing incredible sights, eating at amazing restaurants, or hanging out at your hotel, you'll have lots of time to have fun with your friends. DC is awesome.
DC is exciting.
DC is thebomb.com.
It's a very unique experience.
Educational.
DC is amazing! When you and your friends join us in Washington, DC, you'll watch history come alive on a travel adventure you'll never forget.
I would recommend this trip to other students because it's a really great experience. You get to see a lot of the nation's history and get to have a good time with your friends and you learn a lot.
What more can you say? It's thebomb.com. Ms. Castor Stanton and I, we are the social studies department in the junior high and high school. And this is actually something I've thought about since I started teaching here full time. And I was close other times to bringing this up, but I decided this was the year. You know, it's for 7th, 8th graders, and you have, like I said, you have most information. And myself and Ms. Castor Stanton would be the two main chaperones. If we needed more, we would recruit more. Parents can go on the trip, and the process would be that we would, as soon as this gets approved, we would take it to the students. That's the video they would see, and they would be given a packet to take home to their parents. We'd have a parent meeting about a week later or so, and there was a video the parents would watch and show this to. Last time I checked, it's been a while now, we had, I think, just over 100 7th and 8th graders. That's not how many would end up going on the trip, I'm sure. And the representative I talked to, he said the average is 15% of those invited actually end up going on the trip. And as far as the organization is World Strides. I don't know if you've heard of that, but they've been doing this for 50 years now, and they make it very easy for schools to do this. It's just an awesome opportunity for the students, and in my opinion, they would learn a lot more on a trip like this than they would in several junior high and high school history class, even though I'm a history teacher. Because some students learn differently, and this would be the trip of a lifetime for many of them. Think about how many kids never even get out of their state, let alone to Washington, D.C. And we would be chaperoned by tour buses and by representatives from the organization. They would provide even night chaperones in the hallways at the hotel. Medical things are covered. Probably one of the best hospitals in the nation, I'm not sure, but they're right there in Washington, D.C. Liability is covered. They have millions of dollars of liability because they do this all the time. And other schools do this. I'm not sure if they use this organization or not, but I know Bremen has done it. And I've heard somewhere that there might be a Plymouth school going this year. I know Bremen's at the junior high level also. That wouldn't be a concern to me. Just a couple of things, and I'll see if there's any questions. I don't want to take a lot of time. This would be a hands-on learning opportunity. And as I said, the average is 15% of the students that are invited to go on the trip. As far as the fundraising, that is up to them, up to their families. But World Strides provides e-cards and Facebook posts and letters to make it very easy to get to their family and friends that way to raise funds. There's also, and I thought this was pretty cool, there's financial assistance available. Be like a grant, and it's for families with a combined adjusted gross income of $85,000 and lower. And so I think that's, and there's money available through that assistance program as well. And the good thing about that is that 100% of the money raised goes directly to each student's trips. So this World Strides, they don't take any of that money as a service fee or that organization or whatever it is, that they don't take money for service fees or anything like that either. And there is even an opportunity, and I don't think I sent this information to you, but there's an opportunity for these junior high kids to get high school credit by enrolling and taking online course, and they have to complete within 6 months after the trip. And so they can do that, and that's the potential. And then it would be up to the school whether or not they would accept that. So I don't know exactly how that would work, but there's that opportunity. And one thing that is pointed out, if you're concerned about liability and things, this is not really a school-sponsored trip. It's not meant to be. And that even says that in the parent letter that would be sent out. So even myself and Ms. Cashnet, we would not be going on this trip or attending this as representatives of the school or employees of the school. So also, just one thing that I thought this year was different, because we actually have 2 weeks of spring break. So the trip would be the first week of spring break, 4 days and 3 nights. That's really all I have, other than the information that you've been given. So if you have any questions, I don't know if I can answer all of them or not, but.
And they would bus there from
here? Actually, it'd be a flight.
A flight, and yes. Then to a busing while you're there.
Right, okay. Yeah. Right.
And just the approximate cost, I'm guessing, that you might want to know.
Right, and the student or the parents will be informed of that.
Right.
But the cost per student is $1,724, and that's flight, hotel, all the meals while they're there. The only thing it doesn't cover is souvenir money and that, and snacks and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I think that's a good deal. And I understand the difficulty some parents have, but there is the financial assistance program and so forth. So.
Is there a break even, John, where you have to have so many, like, if we have 3 kids that end up going, is that
that cost that I have is actually based on 15 students, and so that's the 15% of, the 100 possibilities, so.
So we could send less, it would just be more costly for students.
I believe so. All right, any other questions? Thank you.
Thanks for bringing that. That's a new thing. You might be prepared for a lot of spillways, maybe from older kids who didn't get the opportunity. But
that's another thing. If we do it this year, it goes well. It could be coming every other year. So in either their seventh or eighth grade year, they would get the opportunity. So it wouldn't be every year. Something like that, anyway.
And if our numbers, I think, are insufficient for the pricing that you got, perhaps we would expand it to some other grade levels to get numbers that you needed. Yeah, that's just an idea.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I'd have to check with the organization. But But I'm pretty sure we'd find that many out of that number.
Entertain a motion regarding the Washington, D.C. trip.
I will make that motion. Let Mr. Fishburne move forward on this.
Second.
Discussion on that? Go ahead.
I can say this is the first year I was out there. It took me 48 years to get there, and it was pretty impressive. So, make big impact on a lot of kids, I think. So, it sounds like Mr. Fishburne has done his homework. So,
okay, those in favor of the trip to Washington, D.C., say aye.
Aye.
All right, facility update, Mr. Carter. I don't like it when you come here. I'll just start with that.
You probably won't like this.
Yeah. I've seen most of it, and I don't like it.
I'm going to try to move fast on this because we have some important things to get to near the end. First off, summer was a little different for us because, one, we had a short summer. And so that was a different change for us. We had some classroom change. Big thing we had was training of custodial personnel because we had some new people. Maintenance stayed busy. We're doing inspections, repairing equipment that's listed there. We had some room changes that we had to take care of. Department brief. This is kind of interesting. This year we're a half a custodian short due to reduction in force. However, working with Ms. Reese and Mr. Levi, thank you to both of you, we were able to come up with a schedule where we have one person actually cleaning rooms during the day. That change of the schedule actually allows us to hit every classroom. It's now cleaned every day. High school used to be every other day. We're on an every day schedule now, except for rooms. There are some rooms that aren't really used. Those are on a once a week, but we actually increased our cleaning with a half a person less. So thank you for you two for working with us on allowing that to happen. Projects over the summer. Room 106, 108 was painted and recarpeted. If you get a chance, take a look. Student parking lot was crack filled and repaired the drains. If you remember, a few months ago I came with a proposal that our student parking lot is sinking. It's about a $190,000 project to fix it. This temporary repair should give us at least three more years because it's allowing waters to drain properly. Hopefully we'll get more than three, but the contractor felt good about the 3 years. YAG is in the middle of a remodel right now. The roof is probably 90% complete. The classroom is complete, and the siding has began on the north and south side are done. If you have a chance, go out to the Ag building, take a look. It's a big difference, big change. We started a door project where we're every exterior door is getting something done to it, whether if it's a door sweep or new mullion. Every outside door is getting worked on. West door of the library is getting replaced, and the kitchen outside door frame is getting replaced as well because it's rusted where there's actually holes in it, which isn't good. If you remember back a few months ago, I came, did a presentation on some key equipment that we have in the building, and these are things that we looked at. And then we're going to break this down, and sorry, but this is where it gets ugly. Start with the boilers. Currently our boilers are, we have 5 Iroquois boilers, 1 Iroquois hot water heater. They were installed in 1995. Basically they're at their life expectancy right now. If we went to replace the 5 Iroquois boilers, they would be replaced with 2 BMK 2000s. The cost is $21,500 each. I would like to point out that this is the cost of the equipment. This is not the install. Thing I'd like to point out on these, with the recon boiler as well,
By trade, I'm an HVAC person, 25 years in the field. I'm also an AERCO rep. I can do any maintenance on our boilers, and it is certified by AERCO. It took a while to get this paperwork punched through with them, but basically what we're looking at is if we replace our boilers and a hot water heater, there is very little labor costs involved because we can do it in-house. So we're only looking at equipment. It took a while for them to verify, yes, my credentials, and to agree that, yes, I can certify the boilers for the install. So you have to do a startup certification of them. AERCO agrees that I can sign them off. This year, though, we need two Seymour panels. Basically, two of the boilers, all five boilers will run through the winter. Two have to run in manual mode currently. If we had fire up the boilers today for our heating season, two will have to run in manual, which means you set it 20%, you set it 40%, you set whatever that percent is, and it runs that way until someone comes and physically changes the setting, which is not cost efficient. To install a Seymour panel to make it run automatically, they're $4,881 a piece. The thing that I did verify is the Seymour panels do work on the new boilers, so if this is a purchase we made, it's not that we're wasting money. They would be removed, put on the shelf, packaged, put on the shelf. If we ever do have a control panel go bad on the new boilers, we have a backup spare control panel. I'm currently now working on a finance option with Finca Company to later present. They really are not in the finance option, or they're not in the finance business, but it's something that they're going to consider for us. Hopefully I'll be able to come back with some terms of what they're offering to us that we can get this project done at a very low interest rate. We have two circulating pumps that feed the boilers. It's a hot water system. We still currently have no current problems. However, I went out and started looking at new vendors, and I found them for $1,000 cheaper than when I first said that we would be the cost on that. This is where we start getting ugly, unfortunately. Rooftop units. We have a total of 19. 12 of them are between 20 and 21 years old. 20 is the life expectancy on a rooftop unit. Out of the 12, I made it my goal to inspect the heat exchangers on these units prior to our heating season because of their age. To date, I have four left to inspect, but so far what I found is I have three units that have bad heat exchangers. So we have some major issues. Step real quick of what it looks like. If you walk on the roof and you see this is the burner exhaust on it, it's kind of hard to see, but if you look in this area here, you see rust deposits sitting in the screen. Usually when you see that, that's an indication that it's starting to rust out. Something is going on it. And so when you see a heavy deposits here, you need to actually open the unit up and take a look inside, and that's what we did. This is Gym 3. You can look on right there, see there's a crack in that heat exchanger. That unit is now, the heating's been disabled on it. It cannot heat anymore for that area. Moving on, this is the auditorium north lecture area. Same thing, crack in the heat exchanger. Auditorium south lecture area, same thing, crack in the heat exchanger. This is the kitchen area. It's good, but if you look, heavy rust deposits right here. It's going to be a matter of time before the kitchen goes as well. I'm sure we'll make it through this season, but I just wanted to include this one so you know we have another one coming. These units that I just showed you, the gym, elementary gym, was as a 1995 unit. The rest are 96s. This is what a normal heat exchanger should look like. This is a unit that's the same age as the others, but you can look how clean it is inside. Very little rust. Costs on these, and this is something we need direction from the board. The first column here is Gym 3, if we bought a new heat exchanger and put in that unit. $2,349. Once again, there is no labor costs involved because we do the work in-house. If you look at replacing the unit, you're looking at a $19,000 expense. We have to consider the unit's over 20 years old. This is where we need guidance. Is it better to go ahead and do the 20, or should we put the heat exchanger in and you still have an old unit? This number, I will tell you, is high. I got that quote late today. That is a high quote. I asked to be conservative on it. I think realistically we could probably get it down closer to 16,000, because there's things we got in. They went the top number on the crane coming in. They went the top number on labor. Obviously, we would offer assistance to try to cut down on labor, so I think this number could actually drop. The auditorium heat exchanger prices are there. There's a question mark because we don't know yet. That we found that this morning. We inspected these this morning, and I don't have a number on it. I have the lobby here because if you look, and they're hard to see because they're behind the wall, there are three units on the north side of the auditorium, on that side of the auditorium. When you change the units, you're bringing in a crane and you're paying for that crane rental fee that could be anywhere from, say, probably $1,500 to $5,000, depending on the size of crane you need. This unit in the lobby, actually the heat exchanger in it is good, but I'm throwing this as an option to consider replacing it because you have the crane here anyhow. And it's an old unit. It kind of makes sense if you're gonna tackle replacing to go ahead and replace that one as well, because you're gonna save the cost of the crane to come back maybe next year or 2 years from now to reset for that location. In this case, and all these would be in this case, that if we did decide to replace them, things like the heat exchanger will be pulled out of this unit and put in storage because it might fit, say, a different rooftop unit. That if we had one go bad, I would have one, and all the other parts, good parts, will be cannibalized out of the units and saved for other units.
Just a second, Brad, then.
Yes.
To clarify on, if you changed only the heat exchangers on those units, then the crane rental would be unnecessary?
Correct.
Okay.
Because you'll be just looking at this first number here, that would be your expense on change of the units, and that could be an option. But you have to remember that if that's the option we choose, you still have a unit that's 20 years old that later anything could go wrong.
I just want to make sure I understood.
Yes. So I guess from the board with the HVAC is we need a little guidance as far as which avenue you would like us to move. I can tell you with this that if you did the project, there is a rebate. Basically, it's $30 a ton. Gen 3 is a 15-ton unit, so roughly $900 you would get back. These are 3-ton units. $30 a ton is not much money, but there is rebate money for changing them, and obviously you're getting something newer with that's going to be more efficient too, to operate. Next phase I want to hit is lighting. If you notice, I'm going down steps of what I proposed a few months ago. Lighting, we have left all the classrooms, the library, cafeteria, the three gyms are left to convert to LED. We did the hallways and the auditorium house lighting, and it has saved us quite a bit of money. Energy Harness has made a proposal to us. They got us some type of state or some type of government grant that basically what they are offering to us is virtually free financing for the remaining project that needs done to convert the rest of the school to LED lighting. I believe the amount was, correct me if I'm wrong, what was our total amount? It was below $149,000. $149,000 is what we're looking at to finish the rest of the school. That would be everything converted to LED lighting except for the soccer field and the auditorium stage lighting, which is special lighting. What Energy Harness is proposing is that they will finance the project and basically they can't go in 100% interest free. There is a very, very small percent that they legally have to charge. And what they would set up for payment plans is basically your energy savings is your payment plan. So the school is not going to be out a dime for the project, okay? But based it on our energy savings, they gave us, I think in your proposal you have, there's different options. It's recommended that you take the longest one because you can always pay it more faster, but it just relieves more money for if you got other things to come up, which we do. So that option's out there. Another thing that I like to mention is that doing the whole LED project, there is a rebate that you apply for. We're estimating that rebate that we will receive is a $30,000 rebate. That rebate is money that you can take and throw anywhere you want. You know, you can put it in general fund, you can put it in capital projects, you can put that $30,000 anywhere you want. It could even be used to fund the HVAC units that we wanted to do. It's our choice. This is a conservative number that we estimated, the $30,000. This is actually going to be higher, but we're going to say $30,000 just for argument's sake. Thing I like to point out is this program that's offered, this rebate program that's offered is through IMPA. This, from what we are being told, is no longer, this program of rebates is no longer going to be available after January 2017. So when we look at projects like HVAC and a lighting project, and we have gotten rebates back in the past, that's going away. So I kind of need to, I don't need a yes, no answer on the lighting, but what I do need is if we are interested in it, because Energy Harness has a current, has other schools right now that are waiting to take advantage of their offer. If we decide that we do not want to cash in on their offer, they're going to move on and offer it to a different school. So I don't need a, I don't need an answer of yes, we want to do the project. I need an answer of yes, we would like to at least sit down with Energy Harness and look at the proposal is what I'm looking at. And if we're not, that's fine. Like I said, they would move on.
Brad, we get the rebate regardless of if we take the financing option or the direct pay?
The rebate is for completing the lighting project.
Regardless of the
yes. Project. And so, and then the other option, of course, you could take, like I said, the rebate money's for anything you want to use it for. You can take that rebate money and turn it right back on your payments that we owe Energy Harness and make a large cash down to pay that balance that we have.
And then I think there were three payment terms that were shown on the material you provided. The interest rate on all three term lengths is actually identical.
Yes.
I think it was right around 1.7% was
right.
Was the rate.
And that's because they have to legally charge something, and that's the lowest amount percentage that they can legally charge. Because they can't do it interest free, but that's the closest they can do to make it interest free. There are several schools that jumped on board on this. It's in your packet as well with who jumped on it. And it's really a good opportunity to fully get this one project done. When I came prior to, I think it was February, March time frame, we had a list of things we're looking at. I hope you understand that what I'm trying to accomplish here is letting you aware if we have problems, and I'm trying to, my hardest to provide answers of how we can pay for things or how we can move forward to get what we need done, because we all know that, you know, We're a school that's not rich in finances. You see other schools, you know, they put up a $1 million football field and we're scratching our head to figure out how we're going to replace a rooftop unit that has a hole in the heat exchanger. You know, it just, to me, doesn't seem fair, but that's what I'm trying to do is present some needs we have and ways to that we could possibly pay for these things. Moving on, that was on also on my list was carpet. Moving some things around CPF, we were able to start back on our carpet projects. 106, 108, like I said earlier, was done this year. 604 and 606 still need to be done. I've been here at the school 20 years. When I started, it was my goal that every room would be remodeled. I'm two rooms short of meeting my goal. Only took me 20 years to get there. but we also need to start considering the 400 hall. As I said a few months ago, in the 400 hall, I have two classrooms right now that actually have duct tape holding the carpet down because the carpet is ripped. And you know, this is something we're trying to address and fix as we can with financing, you know, the finances we have. Roof, this has been done since our last time I was at a board meeting. We recently just purchased a 10-year extended warranty on a roof, which is good. We've had several leaks with the monsoon rains that we've been having. We had several leaks. It's been taken care of free of charge. The thing with the roof warranty that they are doing is for them to basically make it okay with their underwriters of the policy, they have to go through our roof and they have to repair at their expense any problems that they see. They're currently doing a lot of patching, they're doing a lot of seal coating, and when it's all over, they'll do a roof scan, so we'll have an infrared scan of the roof, so we'll know the condition of the installation, but that's all free of charge. Thing I want to point out, though, is that we need to remember this is a 10-year extended warranty that we just entered. Our last roofing project was a $1.3 million for a whole roof. I'm estimating that in 10 years, you're probably going to be looking at a $1.5 million to do the roof again. So I'm just saying those numbers. So as we look at the next 10 years, you know, things are spinning in our head of, hey, that's coming, because roofs don't last forever. Paving, our current paving, most of it's 19 years old. I've already talked about the student parking lot. Let's see how the winter goes. I mean, I hope that repairing the cracks and redoing some of the drains will give us a lot more than the 3 years. I like to see 10 years out of the parking lot because, you know, I mean, if we throw money around or pay something, I really hate to see it go in paving. To me, that's kind of like the last place I'd like to see our money go. Painting, we're back on track. Once again, 106 and 108 was painted. The ag classroom was painted as well. If you get a chance, go look at the ag building. It's really starting to look nice. Summary, we have a lot of needs. The smaller projects we're able to get done through the budget. We're able to move, we're moving. We're taking care of some business here. We have some large things that's coming up. I mentioned boilers. We need to seriously look at getting those replaced. I mentioned the rooftop units. You know, we could replace heat exchangers. If the money's available and we could find it, I would say we really need to move it, replacing them, because I have 12 that are old. You know, I hate to say this sounds awful, but I'm glad we only have 3 bad heat exchangers. I'm glad it's not 5, 6, or more than that. 3 seems like a lot, but I'm glad it's only 3. And overall, I think we're working on our strategic plan, and I think that we're moving forward. We're on the right track. We just need a little guidance of these larger things of what do you want us to do. Questions?
What's your overall recommendation on the heat exchangers then, Brad?
I would definitely replace Gen 3 because it's the oldest unit, it's a 1995.
Full replacement at the $16,000.
Yes, I would replace that one. To be honest, I would probably look at replacing all 3 of the auditorium if we could find the funds. I know we have some GEO bond money. Depending on what you're doing on the lighting project, there is rebate money that's coming back on that. You can kind of rob out one count knowing that we're going to pay it back. If you can, I would probably recommend replacing all 4 if we could swing that. If not, I would definitely at least do Gym 3 because it's a 95. That'd be my recommendations on that.
Do we have any of those in the capital project fund?
I believe we have $10,000
allocated for 17.
For 2017, just 10,000.
What's the estimated remaining balance of unallocated money from that GO bond issue?
91,000.
I'm sorry?
91,000 remaining.
I'd like to point out too that one of the things we talked about, like I said, that the quote was high, and we know it was high because I needed a number to throw at you tonight. So it's not going to be more than that. We're hoping to bring it down. The other thing that might bring the cost down, and I don't know what the auditorium replacement units will be. I probably won't know until the end of the week. But there's also a possibility that if you're looking at all four, that the company could say, we'll give you a discount because you're buying four instead of one. The other thing that's different is we're not looking at train units, we're looking at American Standards to put in because they're cheaper. If you're in the HVAC trade, you need to know that American Standard makes train, the train puts their name on it, and they jack it up about 20%. You're getting an American Standard unit. Just a little side note, if you even same with your home, if you get a new furnace for your home, American Standard is train. So you're paying for the train name. So what we're quoting out is actually American Standards. It's a train unit, paid by train. So I just want to clarify that for everyone as well. The other thing we're looking at, if we do all four, and like I said, I don't have the quote, and I apologize for that, but we just found out this morning they were cracked. Of course, it would be all organized that when we bring the crane on site, we would be ready to do all four at once. We're not bringing the crane in and out, in and out. If you're ready to go, and because crane fees, Doug, you can probably relate to it. They're
like
expensive.
The helicopters.
Yeah, you pay dearly for a crane, and we're probably talking because where the crane has to sit, on asphalt. It can't go in dirt or grass. The elementary unit has to be a 70-foot crane because of the length it has to extend and the weight. It's a 70-foot crane, which you pay a lot for a 70-foot crane. If it was 50, you'd probably cut your price in half on the crane rental. Any more questions?
Thanks, Brad.
Well, it's good for news, right? And the lighting project, like I said, if we could get some feedback through Ms. Reese on if the board like at least more information on it. But if you do elect that you prefer to pass, I would like to give the other schools the opportunity to jump on this because I think it's a good deal, and you know, I'd like to see us take advantage of it, but if we don't, I'd like to see someone take advantage of the deal.
And Brad, you can get us a quote on a potential discount for all four?
Yes,
I will. Those individually.
Hopefully by the end of the week. The contractor is coming out Wednesday, and also need to point out, of course, this is only one quote. I'll get another quote. I just went with the one that we've worked with the most. I feel very comfortable that I can call and just say, hey, you know, shoot me a quote real quick, and we have that relationship, and I can even close enough that I can barter the price with. A lot of times you can't do that with contractors, but obviously we'll get more quotes before we do the project.
All right. Well, thanks for the good news. Item 10, now we're talking about CPF. This is for the formal approval of the proposed 2017 CPF plan.
Do you have any questions for Jennifer?
questions, I will entertain a motion regarding approval of the 2017 CPF plan.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Discussion. Musical accompaniment. Those in favor of the CPF plan for 2017 as proposed, say aye.
Aye.
4-0. Item 11, bus, new item 11, old item 12, approval of the bus replacement plan. Any comments on that, Jennifer?
Just wanted to, it may look a little strange because the way you're supposed to replace buses every 12 years, and some of ours are a little bit older than that, which are replacement, they're like sub buses. But basically, we currently are making lease payments on our buses about 5 years. And so that's why I did the plan the way I did, to show that as they got to the 12-year point, I put them on the payment plan. And so that's why if you look, some years it looks like we're replacing one, some years it looks like we're replacing four. But basically, I'm putting any new buses that we would purchase, obviously would come before the board for permission, but they would all go on like a 5-year payment plan. And so that is what was reflected on this sheet, which is different than I've done in the past. And also just a comment that the funds that we raise in the bus replacement plan, we have to offset our pension debt payment, and it has to come from another taxable fund. And so bus replacement is generally the fund that we have used to offset that pension debt. And so that's what I am proposing as well. Later tonight, I'll have you sign a tax neutrality resolution that will indicate that we want the Department of Local Government Finance to neutralize our pension debt out of the bus replacement plan. So that's why we try to raise the maximum so that we still have enough money to buy the buses and make the payments, but yet we also need to fund the pension debt.
So we're funding our pension contribution out of the bus replacement plan, really?
Yes, it has to. You don't raise funds for the pension debt. You have to take it from somewhere else. So it has to either come from the capital projects fund, the transportation fund, or the bus replacement. So for us, in years past, it has made sense to take out of the bus replacement plan.
And those are all tax levied funds,
yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Discussion on the bus replacement. Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion regarding that plan.
So moved.
Second. Discussion on that. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Old 13, new 12, approval of 2016. Old 14, new 13, approval of the October meeting date change. And this is pursuant to just a scheduling thing with fall break. We wanted to prepare for the possibility that some of us will not be here over fall break. And so the proposed date is 1 week earlier on that prior Monday instead of the third Monday, then that's going to be the second Monday of October. Help me again with that. The 10th. Okay. At 7 o'clock here in the library. And your motion on that?
So moved. Thanks, give it to Monty. I'll do the second.
Okay, Monty. Doug. Discussion. Hearing none, those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Item 14, presentation of ACT scores.
Well, I think Brad and Nick had a competition to see who would be the longest in the presentation.
Brad won hands down.
I think he's going to win hands down, I think. I don't know. We'll see. So, Nick?
I timed him, so I'm going to keep it to it.
All right, got it. What we received was our ACT scores from the ACT, and basically this is our graduating seniors last year who took the ACT. They reported back to us on how we did. So what I have here is the first chart shows our five-year trend. You can see starting with 2012 to 2016. The first row there is total tested. You can see last year was the lowest number we had students take the ACT. Why that is, we're a little unsure. We got to do some research. Some of it could be some kids just didn't take it. They took the SAT. Some kids are, we have more and more kids going into the workforce. So they didn't feel the need to take it. And then the lines, or the next columns there, deal with our average scores for over those 5 years as well in each of those subjects. And you can see that it wasn't really all that great this year. But we have solutions, so don't everybody panic, okay? Here is the percent of ACT students testing who they feel are ready for college-level coursework on their first year. ACT has established benchmark scores, and I have them listed there. So they're saying if you receive an 18 on your English comp score, they are saying there's a 50% chance you're going to get a B, 75% chance you're going to get a C your first year in that subject in college. Same thing, so the scores they're following, 22, 22, and 23. You can see on our scores, we are the light blue. The number to the right is the state average. So in English comp, it shows that we were a little bit above. College algebra, we were above. Social studies, we dropped down. Biology, we dropped down to meeting all four. Now, remember, those are just the 13 students that took the ACT. So is it a fair reflection of all of our seniors? I don't think so. But it's of those students that took the ACT, okay? So out of, let's say, the 13 students, 10 students, they feel will get a C or better in English. 7 will get a B or C or better in algebra. 4 in social sciences, 5 in bio, and only 2 students met all 4 criteria out of 13, okay? The next one is the average ACT math scores. This is interesting. Basically, the table, again, we are the light blue. Starting on the right-hand side, students that take a math course for less than 3 years, that is kind of how they are scoring. So you can see the states shows that, does it work? Kind of see it. It starts small, the more math you take, the more your scores improve. And we see a nice jump between pre-cal, trig, and calculus. Our AP Calc class, we really shot up. So this is showing us the more our students take math and the higher level math, the better you will do on the ACT. And the data shows that that's true. Okay. Next one is science scores. I've noticed something here. I'll explain. It says less than 3 years. Look at our score. It's pretty good on the far right there. I like it. We're above the state average. Those are students that have taken less than 3 years of science. And as we go left, the more science you add, our scores kind of hover in the same spot. Little up, little down. Remember, this is just 13 students. And when I look at the science courses that they are saying you need to take, we don't offer physics. We really don't have a general science for our high school. So it shows me that, I would think from a science standpoint, we are getting our kids ready. We're just not really capable of giving them the coursework we think to help jump it up. So there's some strategies we're gonna discuss and see how we can fix it. So far so good? Here's what we're going to do, some goals, action steps we're going to take. We still have to establish high academic expectations, and that's the culture of the entire school. We want our kids to go to college. We want them to strive for that. We're not saying you're all, that everyone's going to go there, but you can't tell me taking a high-level math class is going to help you in the workforce. Our curriculum, we're having department meetings, grade-level meetings, and we have to discuss what we're being taught or what's being taught and how. And kind of those skills we want our kids to learn. We're going to evaluate our progress frequently, department meetings, of course. And the biggest thing, I think, is we're going to continue with the AP TIP program and implementation of the strategies and hopefully get this to move in grades 5 through 12. We're hoping at some point we can move it down to third grade and all the way to 12th grade. We're hitting the AP TIP hard this year. Based on the math that I showed you previously, the more math you take, the higher level math, the better you get. We're going to do that in all of our classes. One of our goals for middle school students is to get them starting to think that they are going to take AP classes in high school. No questions, that's what you're going to do. We want them to say, yep, that's what I'm going to do. Whether I become a mechanic or I work in some technology field, I will be taking an AP class. Hopefully two. And again, this is just 13 students. It's not a reflection of all of our seniors that went to college. Any questions for me? That's all I got. Short, sweet, to the point. I don't think I missed anything.
Describe the AP TIP program again for a few who aren't familiar with it.
All right, the AP TIP program, we got lucky and we got accepted into cohort number 4. What it is, it's an agreement with University of Notre Dame. We are now partners with them. And their goal, there's goals that we have. One goal is to increase the number of students who take AP classes. And the second one is to increase the number of passing scores. Their data, their statistics are showing that the more you push kids academically and you prepare them and create a culture of high academic standards, students are successful. Whether it be high school, college, or obtaining jobs outside of that. That's our goal. An interesting thing was homework. That's like the new big thing. AP TIP, one AP TIP teacher says, I don't give homework because I want my kids to really work their butt off in the classroom. It's my job to sit there and teach them how to do it. If I send them home, it's just stressful. One teacher says, no, you're crazy. You have to give them homework because they have to keep practicing. So they all meet and they discuss these things and they come up with these great ideas and, you know, they're smarter than me. So when it comes to teaching that coursework. The program is also, we are trying to get involved with NIMSYs. Which is a supplement to the program that is going to give training to our lower level teachers and also for teachers that don't have the typical STEM coursework. So say Spanish or history, they can also attend these conferences and learn some of the skills of these other AP teachers. And it goes all the way down to, I think, third grade. Our focus right now is STIF. That's kind of where our immediate goal is in the next couple of years to get down to fifth grade.
And when you're talking about passing scores, you're not talking about a passing grade in our local class.
No, passing scores on the AP test, a 3, 4, or 5.
Which then will, in most cases, earn at least some post-secondary credit.
Correct.
For those who are moving on.
Sure, certain universities have certain standards. Some say you have to have a 5. Some say we'll take a 3. The average is about a 4. That's kind of what most schools want nowadays, is 4. However, we've noticed and through our conversations with college admissions directors, they say when it comes down to looking at a student, even if a student is attempting to take that AP course, they are likely to get picked over a student who just has straight A's and never had an AP course. If you take an AP course and say you get a C or a B, it's showing those people that you're willing to take that risk and you're willing to work hard in order to receive credit. And that's a determining factor. They said if you take 2 piles, AP TIP said, from all the conversations they've had, they will take the kids that do average in an AP course. That's a bonus for our little school, I think. We are the small school in this program. They're finding some difficulties with kind of our quota. Like, you know, we're supposed to have benchmarks. We don't offer some of these classes every year, and we'll have 0 in that class. but they're willing to work with us. They're finding some stuff out, and it's kind of changing their process as well.
Any other questions for Mr. Meadows?
Nick, do we get the same intelligence on SAT scores?
I have not received that yet.
But we do get it.
Yes, so we will get those reports at some point, yeah.
And do we push one of those tests more than the other?
I do not. I don't think Mrs. Dell or Mrs. Montel have either. Okay. We want them to take it.
Past practice seems to be that the guidance department would encourage students to take each of those tests at least once, and then whichever of the two they scored relatively higher on, that would be targeted for a second or a third attempt in order to boost those scores. It's been my experience.
Yep. The higher the score, of course, the more dollars they get from universities and things like that. Oh, and this program also, this AP TIP program also has an incentive program that we're trying to be a part of. Basically, if students pass the AP test, they get like $100. AP TIP, University of Notre Dame pays them. I believe it's the university. It's attached to that program. At the same time, teachers would get paid as well, kind of an incentive to do that. Some schools give AP teachers less courses, give them more preps. We don't have that option, so we think this is a fair balance. Teachers are okay with it. No questions for me? All right, thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Zenz.
If I may, Nick brought up the point of what the high stakes are here and how we're doing in the high school. For the 33 years that I've taught here, the elementary grade has always been, the grading scale has been the same. It's nothing new. Because we are a small school, we need to one up that with some of the bigger schools. And having that culture of high expectations, I think we start that in the elementary. Why would we want to lower our standards when the stakes are higher right now?
Thank you for your input.
We just have on there the school board attorney for future discussion.
Yeah, and we've gotten a quote from another legal firm that kind of specializes in the school representation realm, and you know, the cost factor on that particular firm was certainly significantly higher than what we are paying right now for our current representation. So I think at this point, the feedback that we've gotten is we seem comfortable with kind of where we are with the representation that we currently have. It's good to benchmark every so often, and this is the first time in my memory that that's actually been done since I've been on the board. So I think that that particular thing was long overdue. We could look for another quote from another if we'd like, but I think we at least have a comparison so that we have a better idea of the fairness of what we're paying. Claims, item 16.
The claim docket this month has accounts payable claims in the amount of $390,897.34. Payroll claims totaling $237,942.82 for a total of $628,840.16. Are there any questions on the claims this morning?
Okay, hearing no questions on the claims, I'll entertain a motion for approval.
I'll make a motion to set the claim at red.
Okay, already called for discussion. Those in favor of approval of claims signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Item 17, financial reports.
Okay. balance. Our general fund balance this month, at the end of August, was $307,941.44. This balance reflects all of the paybacks for Viva and MetLife that were, had been discussed and approved. It also reflects all but one payment of a retiree, the retirement incentive. All but one was processed in the August timeframe. I take back, there are two retirees from that need payback from Viva that are from left a long time ago, and I'm working on getting a hold of them and finding out how they want their money handled, their small amounts. So that is in the process of getting handled, and but all current teachers are paid back. All the retiree incentives are reflected in the August numbers, except for the one retiree that will be reflected in September.
Questions or comments on the financials? Mrs. Reese.
Okay, I just have a couple items. We're heading into sectional time for athletic teams, and we want to wish everyone good luck as they prepare and finish their seasons. One thing that's going to be neat and exciting the next two Fridays, our kindergarten and first graders are going to prepare to visit Ancillo College as part of the Marshall County Promise Initiative. And I personally want to thank Ancillo College for hosting this event and ensuring that our little ones get a taste of what to do after high school. And I know it's not only just Argos participating, but all the area schools within the county. So I'm proud that Argos gets to be a part of that initiative. Also, I like the town council would like to share that there will be a public town meeting to seek input on the comprehensive plan on Saturday, October 1st. And it's going to be here at the school in the library from noon, from 10 until noon. So please, if you have not seen that notice, jot that time and date down. Again, it's Saturday, October 1st, here in the library from 10 to noon.
That's a come and go type thing.
And then, yes. And then Friday, October 7th is our next PD day, and students will complete lessons at home, utilizing their prom books while our staff is in PD that entire day. Our official count for September is 575.6 students. This is lower than the 588.5 in which Jennifer and I budgeted for 2017, and that is a loss of $73,797.94, and that's to the penny according to Jennifer. So I wanted to make sure that was publicly stated. October 7th is the end of the first grading period. I can't believe that time's already here. I don't know about the teachers. I don't know where it went. Parent-teacher conferences are going to be held on October 12th and 13th in the evening, beginning at 3:30 p.m. So watch out for more information to come home from your child's teachers. And then fall break, as someone alluded to earlier, is the week of October 17th through the 21st. And that's all I have to update everybody.
Board comments. Monty.
I don't think I have any this evening.
That was nice.
Jennifer?
Thank you for your input. As we spoke during the public comment, we like to get those things and hear those things. And thanks to Johanna for her presentation on Old Gold. And I see a lot of you here that maybe can join us in that committee. It's not just for parents, it's for community members, grandparents. Anyone really who wants to donate their time to help our kids,
Douglas.
I think I have to go to Mr. Fishburne. And I thank everybody for everything that they do, but he and his partner in crime have stepped up to do the trip to Washington, D.C., and I think that's huge. And it just kind of shows you the kind of person John is, that he's willing to take on this kind of stuff. And that's kind of a reflection of all of our teachers. So, you know, congrats to him for stepping up. Thank you. And, you know, all of our teachers.
I don't really have anything for tonight. I do want to point out that we do have that collaboration with RTC TV. And so tonight was kind of a test run for filming.
They will be doing. And our three gentlemen.
And these wonderful students running around here, manning the cameras. This will be cleaned up. Hopefully I'll be edited out entirely. And then it will be posted on the web. And I think in the future, they will certainly be recording them again. I don't know if it's going to be a live stream or a delay, but it will be available online for those of you who want to maybe watch and see if there was something that you wanted to hear again or check to see if you heard correctly. We still love to have a crowd, and hopefully we'll still have quite a few here in attendance in person on board meeting nights. But if there's one where you happen to be out of town, you miss whatever, just know that the capability is there for streaming. They're doing a lot of different school activities. They're doing a lot of sporting events. They're doing a lot of like programs, variety show, musical, concerts, whatever it is. They're going to be having those available for streaming on the web as well. So we thank them for their partnership, and we hope that that's going to be a real enhancement for everybody. Thanks for coming. And
Justin, I think
that stream will be on RTC4's website, not on ours. That's their stream.
Okay.
So everybody's aware.
Do we have a link tomorrow?
Yeah. I'm putting a link on there directly to their website. But yeah, the stream will be available there.
Okay. Thanks for the clarification. All right. Entertain a motion to adjourn. No discussion. Those in favor of adjournment say aye.
Aye.
And we are adjourned at 8:57.